Hi everybody, this is Shree, Shree's in a Circle. Welcome to a video. This session, I just want to explore the benefits of meditation and what is meditation for me. I mean, it's completely unscripted, non-researched, just expressing from my experience from the core of me. I feel that along the many years, you know, that I've meditated, it has truly helped me to experience the non-logical. Does that make sense? You know, the non-logical, because we are very logical. We're very logical beings. We're very logical. We're like seeing is believing. And we believe in a lot of our thoughts too. But what I've come to understand, okay, is that there's a lot of things very interesting in this vast cosmos where I'm just a speck that I cannot understand through mental cognition alone. I can't really understand through the books alone. But when you meditate, it's very hard to say because you have to experience it. So meditation is experiential. There is an inner world that opens up in you and a shift happens. And a lot of times we want to be able to quantify it, describe it, analyze it, and understand, you know, the part of us that's greedy, you know, the part of us that's ego attachment wants to know, so what? How is that going to affect my life? Am I going to get that new promotion? Am I going to get... No, sometimes you just don't know. And that's how it is. And inshallah, you know, you let it go, let it be. It just feels great. Live it in the moment and experience it. Very hard. It's like you also start to see as you meditate more and more the serendipity. Am I saying that word properly? But you notice things in the current moment that you probably didn't pay attention to. Like the other day I was telling my friend, we were sitting on a square near the office, and I noticed this lady across the street wearing a beautiful green dress. And I just said, hey, she's got a beautiful green dress. And I loved her dress, the way it flowed, sashayed, you know, the whole design of it. And then as we finished our lunch and we were walking back to our office, there is the same woman with the green dress just walking opposite me. And I went, hey, is that a coincidence or is it meant to be? But, you know, things like this, you start to notice, right? And a sort of intuition, you develop a stronger and stronger intuition. And so therefore, I'm also very excited to do our next chakra series meditation on the third eye chakra, which is the blue color one. It's blue azurite crystal. The third eye chakra, your intuition. The more you meditate, the more powerful your intuition becomes. And the more dreams you also have that foretells almost like your future. Just last week, I had a dream of something happening at the workplace with a certain person. And I just woke up in sweat. And lo and behold, in the same week, an incident happened with that person that I had a wake-up call, you know, because I remembered my dream and I went, there's two ways in which I could react. One is I react and I become defensive and I call names on that person and I decide to react in anger within myself and, you know, or I see it as it is meant to happen. As in like the Akashic Records, this event is meant to happen. I had a dream about it, and so it's happening right now. And so thank you. The karmic action has ripened, happened. And am I going to deepen, or let's say create a negative karmic connection with this person? Or do I forgive this person and forgive myself for what happened and take accountability and responsibility for what I've done? Okay, everybody makes mistakes sometimes, and sometimes I do too, and it's nobody's fault. I take full accountability, and I spend some time to bless the person, thank the person for what has happened, and take full accountability. Then a dream I had a few days after was that this same person came to help me, to provide help when I need it. So in that way, my dreams, very cool, right? So meditate more. So my dreams are telling me, like, in a way, my karmic actions and how it's leading to almost my future is a direct guide. So you have access. I mean, as you meditate and you do a lot of purification, you are purifying your karma, your karmic debt that happened in the past. And so whatever bad deeds you have done before, you know, like, it happens, it comes into fruition. But instead of this, maybe a more severe proportion, it is much less than before. So whatever it is, it's the grace of God, and you just take it and take accountability for it and release. Very important to release, because that's what I also start to have more and more realizations, and that comes with meditation. You know, you can read from it, you can listen to me speak, it might make sense, it might resonate, but as you meditate, you have these downloads of aha moments where you go, whoa, that really makes sense. And because it makes sense, because it comes from your inner core, you realized it from your inner core. So, like, for example, how at every moment we are creating karmic action. It's so easy. You can be out in the public, walking on the street, you come across this person, and then you just decide, I don't like that person. For whatever reason, just the whole energy, the resonance, you feel repelled by the person, or vice versa. You feel attracted. You go like, wow, what a cute kid, a cute dog. What a nice person. I like that person's smile. And just naturally, you have a lot of metta and a lot of compassion. And you have like this sense of affinity with this person. So at every moment, we are attracted, or we're repelled. It's like this push and pull all the time. And that's when beautiful feelings, happy feelings, you see this person, it's like a long lost friend. That's great. The challenge is when this person annoys you and you don't even know why. You can't put a finger to it. That person's energy just completely repulses you. And that's when I go, aha! You know, again, it's like, I don't want to create karmic connection with this person. Can you imagine having this continuity of connection with this person? So I go like, okay, I need to remind myself, as Neem Karola Baba Maharaji, I love this guru. Okay, it's like he's just love. Like he said to Ramdas, remember, you have to remember, love everybody and don't tell lies. And when I saw that video and I went, okay, that's what Maharaji says, love everybody and don't tell lies. I'm like, yes, that is such a challenge, isn't it? Especially when it comes to your so-called enemy, you know, people that you don't feel completely attracted to. It's like, love everybody, Ramdas, and don't tell lies. So that's when I go, yes, indeed. You know, we're on this karmic journey. We create so much karma in a day, in a multi-second, that having mindfulness, this loving awareness, creates a sense of heightened awareness that you want to reduce your karma. So at that point, when you are in, you know, you come across this person, you feel not attracted to, you feel these feelings coming in you, just remember that you are not the mind. you're not even the body, and you can chant a mantra. Om Namah Shivaya. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Just chant a mantra. Om Mani Padme Hum, or just simply Om. Meditation, again, it's phenomenal. You just go deeper into your true self. That's what it is, because all the core, what you call layers and layers and layers of that you built up, that you thought is your identity, it just kind of like peels away. And a great form of meditation for me, I mean, you have the formal sit down meditation, you close your eyes and you focus on a spot, so you have samadhi, you develop concentration. For me, and this is what I would recommend to our active, lifestyle people, always going about stuff and who always say, I don't have time to meditate, right? Is that you can do active meditation. And this, truly, I've been working on this recently and phenomenal. Like how much intuition I've developed, so much sense of deeper connection and peace. Oh my gosh. So are you ready for it? And that is chanting. And you don't have to sit down and chant, which is great. It's really to choose your favorite mantra, whichever comes to you as a gift. And again, there's so many mantras. A mantra has a powerful energy, very divine. Just chanting the mantra opens up all the energetic channels within your body. Again, I'm saying this because I'm parroting it off from what I read. How is it happening in me? I don't know. It is happening. It is happening. Chant a mantra. Just chant a mantra, whichever mantra that you love. Om Ara Ba Cha Na Di, Manjushri's mantra. Om Mani Padme Hum, it's His Holiness, the Dalai Lama's favorite mantra. Om Namah Shivaya, I love Shiva, Shiva's mantra. So many mantras. Jai Ram. Ram 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 Sitaram Sitaram. Can just keep repeating the syllables. So because there's so much times when you're not actively talking, you could be doing your housework, you could be working, you could be walking in transport, driving a car, and instead of doing the phone thing, right, is to just chant. Ram 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 Sitaram. So simple word syllables, seed syllables like Om. Just keep repeating it over and over and over and over again. You can say it silently in your head. That's what I do. And when no one's around, you don't feel less embarrassed. You can actually say it out loud. So that way you give your mind a task to do, which is your, it's like, it's good. The mind has a work to do because it likes to think. It likes to, lots of stories going on in this monkey brain. You give it a task to do. And it will do it. It will just keep chanting. Watching TV, and then you're like, you're listening to your, in a meeting, so boring sometimes, and you just go, you're listening to someone talk to you instead of like, wanting to cut that person off, and you just chant in your head, you pay attention. See, there's so, you can be in constant meditation that way. Before you fall asleep, it's excellent as well. A lot of people can't sleep because a lot of times you're thinking too much. What happened in the day? What this person did to me? What I'm going to do tomorrow? What I'm going to go back and do to that person? Whatever. A lot of these storytelling. Instead, you just chant, ram, 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 ram. Sitaram, 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 Ram, 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 Sitaram, 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 Ram, Ram. See? Like this. If you close your eyes and you chant as well, and when you do that, sometimes you develop this very nimitta, you develop this inner light. You know, although you have your eyes shut, there's brilliant light, or you see a doorway and it's full of light, and you start to see beyond what is physical, and you get into the infinite that is where we're going, you know, towards the cosmic infinite space, and not just limited within our mortal beings. And that is the aim of it all, is to arrive home, which is love. And chanting, this form of active meditation through chanting, repeating the mantra, the seed syllable, it's called japa. You know, the word japa, I researched it today, but the word japa came into my mind this morning, and I went, japa, what does it mean? And so I checked on the internet, and I realized this is repeatedly chanting a mantra, and it came to me. So yeah, this is miracles like this happen, you know. So meditate, it's beautiful. I feel like there is an awakening and a true manifestation of an aligned path that will come to you when you meditate. It's as if the angels, the celestial beings, will pave your way for you forward, so you can just live in complete trust and surrender. At moments when, you know, you have to do something, when you got to call someone, that thought will come to you just like this. And often with intuition, you realize that that was the right thing to do. Very, very strange, very beautiful how things, events unfold very synchronistically in your life. Beautiful life you will have. And I want to share with you now about two beautiful manifestations that just really happened. And one is, you see this bracelet I'm wearing, it has these red beads. So I dreamt in July about, in a dream, a woman came to me and she said, cinnabar. I'm like, huh? And she said, use cinnabar for your meditation, for protection. So I'm like, what is cinnabar? So it's just cinnabar. So that's what she kept saying in my dream, cinnabar. And after this dream, I checked up on the internet, what is cinnabar? Cinnabar is the crystal of mercury. So it has high mercury content, very highly toxic, but it's been cherished for its color red. So the pigment red is used for, you know, art making lacquer in India, in China. A lot of buildings are painted cinnabar red. The ladies in India in the past, I'm not sure of it now, they have the red mark of a married woman, I think. And it's made of cinnabar before. Sandush is made of cinnabar. So I'm like, And for me, I take it as a message from Deva, because again, very beautiful. Na? In the dream, I was chanting, I was doing my japa that week on Manjushri's mantra. Om Arapachanadi, Om Arapachanadi, constantly. And then in my dream, Devi. I'm like, oh, Devi. So I woke up and I realized that, okay, I must not neglect the goddess. So I started this month in September and August to pray to Devi, hence the video I made on the Devi. So beautiful. So the Devi worship and the goddess worship, Shakti, which is, then I also read, Shakti is the root chakra. She resides in the root chakra. And then she will rise up to meet Shiva, which is in the crown chakra. So beautiful, isn't it? And cinnabar, red, Devi, red. All residing in the root, practicing the root chakra meditation too. So all these little pieces, you know, this is like how probably God whispers to you. And so I thought, man, I really want to have cinnabar, but crystal shops don't sell cinnabar, right? And I don't want to go purposely to go procure and buy from the internet and stuff. So just this weekend, I went to a jewelry fair, and the very first few stalls that I was there, I saw a young lady who sold bracelets that she made on her own. And of course, this one stood out. And I had no idea when I picked it up, she said, oh, it's made of cinnabar. And when she said that, I knew I just had to have it. And I also learned that she got the cinnabar beads from her grandmother, and she's from England. So it comes from her family lineage, you know, so it's really authentic. I just love the history of it, and now I'm wearing it, you know, things like this. So I've got my Shakti connection now. The other beautiful dream, like, this is a pretty long video, but it's like so much to share in one. And I just want to like share with you about these a little bit mysterious aspects, right, that comes to you. So it's like from the dream, and then this beautiful connection with this human being, then I got my cinnabar and chanting, you know, the Devi prayers, like the Devi just gave you the cinnabar, right? So I just say thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Ma, thank you, Ma. The other dream is from my grandmother. I dreamt very probably back in, yeah, again, everything happened in July, it seems, and this year. And I dreamt of my grandmother's house. It's completely bare. And when I visited it, she's already passed on, my grandmother. My nanny saw me and she said, would you like to sleep here? And I said I couldn't, because actually she was proposing me a marble bed made like the shape of the Buddha's hand or feet. Very beautiful. And I'm like, no, this is too sacred. I can't sleep on it. And my grandmother was there looking at me. And so, you know, I had this connection with my grandmother, and my mom told me that they're trying to sell the house back in Burma, and they couldn't sell it yet. It's up in the market, but no takers. And so I felt like, yeah, Mom, maybe it's because my grandmother is still there, or like, you know, something is still not done yet or complete yet for the sales to be made. It's a lot of history. It's been in the house and the family for a long time. And then the significance, I'm not sure. But then recently, just to come to the connection with it, I have a crystal friend, she sells me crystals. And she, on one of the live auctions, Julie said, these are some Jade Buddha hands. And so when I saw it, I was like, oh my gosh, I gotta have it, because it looks just like, and I'm gonna bring it to you, it looks just like in my dreams, the bed, except of course it's miniature in size, and it's jade, the front and the back. And this was the bed in which my helper, my nanny, Titi, who's not like my mom, proposed that I sleep in. This jade engraved Buddha's palm. So I bought it, and now it's in my hands. It's in my hands. My grandmother's connection, my osteopath, Pascal, she also told me, like, we had this amazing session. She said, I can feel like one of your maternal ancestry has a shamanic connection, a very strong shamanic connection, because of my right shoulder. And she said, something's got to do with your grandmother's connection. She's very psychic, by the way, so she's great. And I told her, because of the dream, I told her there was this big, beautiful tree that was all laden with apricots, so like huge orange fruit, very sweet. And I could go into the cave at the bottom and I could see the roots of the tree, and there was a waterfall, water coming down from the roots. And I even tasted the fruit, which didn't taste much, but yeah. I saw the leaves, I felt it, you know, they're not perfect like all leaves are. I felt the fruit and I saw this fountain. So my osteopath told me, I feel like there is a shamanic, very strong shamanic energy from your grandmother side, mother's side. And so when she asked me, I said, I don't know. I'm not sure. I kept thinking it's my dad's side because my dad's also very, very spiritual. I said, no, I think it's coming from your grandmother's side, your mom's side. And so when I felt and thought about it, it's true that my grandmother's grandfather was a bit of a shaman himself. And he was a learned scholar, and he was connected to the king in ancient Burma. So he was given land for himself, and he was the village head of that land. And his main task was to be the judge of whatever trivialities happened in that village, because it was so peaceful back in those days, nothing much happened. And so he spent a lot of time reading Buddhist texts and translating them into the Shan dialect, because that's where my grandparents are from. They're from Mogot, which is the mountainous region in the Shan district in Burma. So he's been translating the very first Buddhist text into Shan so that the people, the locals, they could understand, because it was all written in Burmese and nobody could understand Burmese. So he was a scholar and he was also promoting Buddhism, and then he taught Buddhism, and at night he would sleep very, very early. He says, when the leaves are asleep, I go to sleep. So around 4 o'clock, he's gone to bed, wakes up at 3 in the morning. He flips his clothes upside down because he says that the ghosts wear the clothes upside down. He just wants to mingle with them so that they don't cause him harm. He'll go out in the forest and he'll chop down bamboo. So he'll bring it back home and make these bamboo-styled puppet shows and depictions of the life of Lord Buddha for his grandchildren, who obviously are not interested. So his wife, who adored him and worshipped him, would make lots of cakes and sweets to attract the grandchildren to come and watch their grandfather's show. So then my psychic osteopath said, yes, it's him, it's him, it's him. And she said something very remarkable. She said, sometimes, you know, people have very strong shamanic energy, but if they don't know how to manage it, it can be very wreckful. So she said, you know, he had a lot of energy. And she said, that's why it's coming through to me right now. He left an imprint and an energetic message. And that's why you're reading it right now. He's talking to you right now, like quantum, you know, like from his time period till now. He left this message for me to feel, and that connection too. So then, of course, naturally, I asked Pascal, and I said, how do I develop my shamanic energy and my talent and power? And she said, I don't know. You have to figure it out for yourself. So I was so intrigued. I still have my hand popped. My hand is still in pain. So then I've been developing, you know, and meditating ever since July a lot more intensely, because I feel like this is a sign from the universe, right? It's like I'm just not going to whittle away my time leading a very mundane mortal life, which I love, but there's also another mission for me, which is more deep, more spiritual, and develop that connection to God, source, so that I can help others, so that I can heal others and heal myself in a way. And that's how it comes back to prayers, chanting, devotion, bhakti, and meditation. And then all these little miracles come into your life to show you that you're on the right track. And so therefore ends this very long video. It's 30 minutes. If you're watching, if you have subscribed, you know, I really love to hear from you. Leave me a comment. And I thank you for being in my life, you know, and have this beautiful connection, all of us together on this planet Earth. So, namaste. May you be well, happy, and peaceful. Blessings. Bye for now. Shri's in a circle.